Welcome to the Candy Shop Show. This is Candy broadcasting from Southwest Missouri, and we just appreciate all our fans live tonight and watching on YouTube. Boy, I hear more and more people that are friending me on Facebook, and so it's Candy Carol on Facebook, and you can link to me from Elizabeth Diamond's page or Christopher Jacobs, who will be our guest speaker tonight.
My intentioner has been working pretty good, Candy, so trust me. My intention is for you to get 5,000 friends on Facebook and Christopher Stephen Jacobs to get 5,000 friends on Facebook, okay? Sorry, I wanted to add that for fun.
Okay. Well, this is our show for January 20th, 2016.
I'm not feeling good, but she went up early.
And let's see. So let's get started. We've see what we've got with the candy jar treat. My goodness. A fella told me today, gosh, Candy, you were right last week when you said the stock market was going to continue to drop Friday and again on Tuesday. And he was looking a little sour in the face with his 401k. They said the average American has lost $9,000 on their 401k in the last 3 months. And so that's kind of making some folks nervous. But here on the Candy Shop Show, we're positive, we're optimistic, we're looking forward to a change, a complete change in the financial situation and a new, more fair financial plan for everybody on the planet, not just the top elite. So, yes, it dropped again today, and everybody always says, well, it goes down, but it comes back. Well, I'm here to remind you that the galactics are saying, nope, someday it's not going to come back. And so consider what you and your friends are going to do. When are you going to actually get out of the market? Well, let's see. Of course, people are very excited about things happening in with the election. It goes right along. But, of course, the Galactics have said that they're really, you know, they reaffirmed Monday night that there won't be an election in November 2016 because of the changes that are going to be wrought after of the disclosure. And so this is just a sideshow for right now, in my opinion. But let's see, it can be kind of an interesting one. Now, Benjamin Fulford was telling us early Monday that there was a lot of changes, and he mentioned that there was going to be one of the first big mega banks that would be folding, and he went ahead and revealed that on Tuesday, and that would be Citibank. He predicts that Citibank will be the first of the giant ones to fold. And it sounds like the Switzerland is getting kind of fed up with the criminality of the big banks, and they're wanting to separate themselves from them. So things are moving right along in those directions. Let's see, candy jar treats also are talking about not only treats from current events, but spiritual treats. And I want to say that I went out on a limb today and I organized and conducted my first formal guided meditation event. And it went really well. We had some fans from the Candy Show there and met in a private home in Joplin, Missouri. And I just felt my guide, Raul Tindar, and the others coming close, and that it was a really special meditation time today at 2:30 Central Time. And I might be asking Chris later if he got any message from our efforts. You know that COBRA and the ETs, the resistance, everyone is asking us to think positive and to meditate and to meditate more and more. And I hope that we're all remembering to do that. And sometimes people like to chant when they meditate. There's all kinds of, we've talked before about chanting mantras like joyful loving. And, of course, some people like to chant Om in the mornings and Om in the evenings. So try different things, but just above all, smile and be positive. And I'm already telling people when I see in the stores and on the streets, have a happy Valentine's Day. And so you say that to somebody and give them a big smile and they'll smile back at you. Well, that's it for the candy jar treats at the moment. And welcome again to all the folks that are coming in. Christopher, are you ready to get going soon?
Yes, I am.
Great. Well, this is show 358 for those of you who want to tell your friends to listen to it on the playback station. And so it is show 358. Before we get going, I think my friend and mentor, Elizabeth Diamond, is here and that she might have a short commercial. Elizabeth, come on in.
Candy, I'm just smiling listening to you. It's like, oh my God, you are getting so positive. You're gonna outshine me. It's like, oh my God. I was telling myself, oh God, I'm gonna have to upgrade now. Candy's catching up with the positive thing. But that's great. I just wanted to let everybody know we have I just want to explain patrons and benefactors. You know, patrons can be like the Diamonds Network. Patrons can be a show, a business. And then there's benefactors who contribute in many different ways, you know, money, whatever, or their resource for their company, whatever. But it's very important to get a balance with patrons and benefactors in everything, if you think about it. I was thinking about that today, and it just kind of hit home. But with the Diamonds Network being conquering with love, the love power and positive power and happy power, and the balance of the patrons and benefactors, Diamonds Network and benefactors is really important, and you guys join in that. So I want to, and I've been putting that intention out for the last couple months and announcing it on the shows, and I'm finding our intentions are working really fast, you guys. So be careful what you think or want, okay? And you want to practice on what you think, you know, and that's what Candy's been encouraging us too, what she just talked about. But I'm happy to announce we have a benefactor in a kind of way. His name's Ted Winslow, and he'll be a guest with Chris and all of us on the Diamond Show coming up February 1st on the Monday show. I'll just read a little bit about him. He has I compose electric sound healing arrangements through the use of Solvigio frequencies. Most of my music is done outside of the 440 hertz. 440 hertz is the standard tuning we use in most of today's modern music and is actually a dissonant frequency. I have found that by incorporating my sound sync tech technology, theta waves, along with the tunings of the sacred Solfeggio frequencies and other sound healing frequencies, I am able to take the listener on a spiritual healing journey that they can use every day to bring themselves back to healing state of relaxation and oneness, and maybe during your meditation time, like Candy just talked about. This is a great way to rid the body from the everyday negative energies we might be subjected to. And I'll end there. I want to just read one little testimony that Ted's got, and I'll tell you the benefactoring that we're doing with Ted Winslow. Let's see, Diamonds commercial. Sorry, guys, I just got to get there. And I suppose scroll down.
Well, that sounds great for Monday show, and that starts an hour earlier than our Wednesday shows, the Diamond Network. And we had a great show last night at 7:30, and tomorrow night we'll be on at 7:30 Central Time, and I will be presenting material about Anastasia's teachings and the Law of One. And Elizabeth, what's the book that you
Sunshine Before the Dawn. Sunshine Before the Dawn. We're learning the galactics who made our DNA, and it's a very beautiful book. And by the way, Candy, I'm going to spill out on you now. I talked to Cynthia. We're going to do two Thursdays in a row because then it'll line up for what Thursdays they want. Okay, so we'll do this Thursday and next Thursday. That's okay.
Got it.
But I wanted to finish with Ted. I won't read any testimonies tonight. I'll do that on another show. But this offer is only on Diamonds Network, and the link is on the right-hand side. It says Sound Healing Fundraiser. You use the coupon code DIAMONDS31. You get 30% off of all his music albums, some music he's gotten from the Galactics. And you'll see that on there. We've played it in the background on the Pioneering show, and we'll be doing more with that, joining in with the Diamonds Network shows. But click on that, you'll see a little YouTube showing the scientificness of it, and you'll see Ted's website. So you get 30% off. So go check it out. That's it. Thanks, Candy and Chris.
Sure. Thank you, Elizabeth. Okay. Well, Chris, do you have any remark about the candy jar treats tonight?
Let me see. Yeah, as soon as you were saying talking about the financial, reset. I heard the month of October pop into my head. Now, I don't know whether that is 2016 or 2017. All I heard was October. And that's the one thing that popped into my head.
Okay. I'm kind of hearing 2016 for the financial reset. Well, this is wonderful. Well, what we do want to invite all the galactics to come into the show and help Christopher Stephen Jacobs here as we connect with our star brothers and sisters, and we want to welcome them to come in too. Did you get any feedback about our meditation this afternoon at 2:30?
Let's see. They felt. Let's see. I'm just getting more of an energy feeling than words. It's more of a calm feeling. So this tells me that they are actually liking what was done.
Wonderful. Some of us are studying sacred geometry a little more in detail. And I was wondering if we had a galactic brother that would like to say a few words about the importance of a sacred geometry and using the flower of life in our meditations and as a mandala, etc.
Okay.
You want to say anything about sacred geometry?
Yes. It looks like when you were talking about sacred geometry, it was actually Michael that showed up, because since he's the creator of it, he'd be the best one to consult on this. At least he told me he's the one that came up with the sacred geometric truth, as he calls it. So I'll see what he has to say here. He's saying, I am Mikhail. I am the one, as this one said, that has created the sacred geometrical truth. I sprang forth on the day after the advent of what you humans would call the Big Bang, the mark of the number 3 was brought forth from the original 1 universe. 3 then became 6, then became 9, etc., and became all manner of geometric truths, all stemming back to the number 3. 3, besides 1, is the most powerful number in the universe because of its beginnings as the original geometric truth. You would call it triangular in nature, the very first shape of its kind. This truth stemmed out from 1 and became many, became the planets, became the stars. This 3 became the amplifier of oneness. This 3 became what you humans know as the Trinity. However, the church has corrupted its original meaning. I, Kale, have said to this to them on many occasions that this mark of 3 cannot remain corrupted. I went to the church heads, very similar to that of heads of state, and I said to them, please do not corrupt the 3, for its message is much more divinely inspired than their inklings, as it were, for control. They denied my request for their control to wither and die. As I said before, when I went to the 3 cabal heads, they corrupted the 3 in the same identical way. However, to match this 3, there are 3 others out there. 3 others that are not associated with the cabal or the church. These 3 are good. These 3, as you know, are the 3 heads of the Pleiadian voice: Hoag, Christos, and Ortan. They are the other aspect of this triad. They have split up to try to correct these other 2 aspects, so the 3 is no longer corrupted. They were able to succeed in getting the one you know of as Pope Francis in as the Pope to correct the religious side of things, aspect of things, as was revealed to you this past Monday night. Pope Francis is Valiant Thor's right-hand man named Unya. You know him as a Cyclops. My goal is to replace the 3 cabal heads in such a manner. However, their position is quite fortified and quite entrenched, as you would say. Their triad is unstable. Their voice is even more unstable. So, in the midst of sacred geometrical truth, I have implemented my own shape upon their thought patterns. This shape is of my own geometric truth. It represents more than what is known in the realms of mankind. This shape is that of the pentangle, or the pentacle, as some have known. The cabal has disrupted this pentangle and you turned it and twisted it into what people know as the pentagram, its opposite and polar distortion. The Luciferian religion, as they call it, uses this geometric abomination to incite discord amongst mankind, even the one they accredited to, my dear friend Lucifer, would never condone such actions, as he has stated in the past. He stands with me now to also address this truth. And now Michael's stepping back in place of Lucifer, and he's saying, my name, as you know, is Lucifer, and I also have helped to enhance this sacred geometric truth through mathematics and through pre-designated, as you say, coordinates. Though this does not make sense at first glance, it will in the coming years and decades and centuries to come. These three cabal heads, as this one calls it, or three heads of the snake, will not survive the coming of days. This bastardization, as you say, of the sacred geometric truth will not stand. This polar dualistic opposite, this pentagram to the sacred pentangle, though it is needed in a realm of dualism and dualistic thought and dualistic wavelengths, as you humans would say, as you ascend, so shall the dualistic seed, as it were, disappear. Granted, this was in its own right pre-planned, a lie becoming the truth. However, the cabal three heads of state, as you humans would say, have taken it way too far. This geometric truth has been used to harm many, and this was not the original intention. It was used to create machines of horrible power, create people that would be slaves on a whim, create ill intention through its polar opposite, as the point faces downward into what you humans would call the shadows or shadow realms. It draws forth out from that those realms onto the earth, as does the light positive version of the symbol, a draw from the positive etheric energies from the etheric plane, or ethereal plane, as you say. These planes, the plane of shadow and the plane of etherism, both exist as they should. However, the plane of shadow will not have its talons or fangs sunk into the neck of humanity any longer. This shadow plane, it wasn't always a bad place. It was just made up of beings that could not be in the light, not meaning that they could not be in the etheric light. It's just that they were more like your bats are to the sunlight. A very different way of dealing with things. But over time, your cabal individuals began to corrupt the plane of shadow and turned it into what they thought I wanted. This is not true. I never wanted an ideal of hell or any realism of hell. The plane of shadow began to reflect thoughts of these individuals, but I have since cleansed the latter half of that equation. When I met the individuals aforementioned in that realm, they are no longer corrupted. This, I also say to these cabal individuals, this triad, this most fearsome monster, as they would say, or beast, your power is nothing. Your power is fleeting. Your thoughts of darkness will not stand. This sacred geometric truth with its polar opposites will be merged into one symbol. This one symbol will then be shown forth as a star in the night. A new symbol will emerge. You would call it the Merkaba, or the Jews would call it the Star of David. This star was not what people think that it is. It was a vision of the future. This future, this present, it stemmed from this time frame and an ancient time frame, all rolled into one in this present day and hour. This Merkaba, or as this one called it, a midnight star, is also what is reflected in the negative half of humanity's reflection, what they must deal with. This also symbolically represents the other sun that is in your solar system as of right now, sending these waves and particles towards the Earth. This sun will only aid in your evolution, as will this symbol. This symbol has already gained the eyes of humanity. Now it must gain the breath and the ears of humanity, along with the voice of humanity. Though this does not add up to three, it approaches yet another number which is of great relevance, and that is the number five. Five meaning the five galactic ages that have passed. These five galactic ages, though spoken of on this call before, is of great relevance since you are in the fifth and final galactic age before the lines will disappear altogether when you go into fifth density. Yet again, another five. This also coincides with the Merkaba, even though many have drawn it in many different ways. The five is always relevant with the Merkaba, as is three, as is seven, as is 11, as is 22, and of course 33. These are all sacred geometric numbers that people have misconstrued throughout the ages. But now we are here to clarify their actual meaning. The number 11, unfortunately, was associated with your trade towers falling on 9/11, and it created a bad stigma, as you say, with it. This is not so. The term that people believe is confirmation, 11/11, is actually the Ra group communicating with people and confirming their positive thought patterns. This is what the number 11 was supposed to represent. It is only in modern times that we were able to utilize it through your time system in order to bring about change in people's thoughts. People see it on clocks. People see it on their phones. People see it everywhere. This leads to 22, which is a pairing of both a confirmation and a question, the cause and effect, the alpha and omega. Then this leads to 33. People associate this with the age Jesus Christ was when he died on the cross. This is slightly inaccurate, though he was that aged in people's minds at that time, and he said that he was somewhere around then. It is totally and completely wrong. 33 would be the number 3 said within the number 11, and confirming a question, an answer, and, as you say, an energy wavelength all rolled into the Trinity, as you say, as Christians would say, Father, Son, Holy Spirit, or Holy Ghost, as the case may be. This has also been misconstrued in history, but I will not go into that just yet. Jesus can take care of his own history when the time comes. He too has falsified his history to some minor extent, so people had to learn and listen to their own intuition. But again, I will let Jesus, or as the case may be, Enlil, deal with his own history at a later date. I will only say this further about Michael and I's sacred geometry. The corruption of the symbols will not stand in the new age. So I and Michael say this to the cabal heads of state. Again, your power is but a fleeting dust particle, a flickering of shadow in the light of the universe. You have nothing to offer anyone. You have nothing but change to offer anyone. So my suggestion to you is change or be removed from the playing field, as humans would say. Thank you.
Oh, Lucifer, thank you. Thank you for sharing all of this information and using this means to remind the cabal heads what they must do. This is quite wonderful, and appreciate that Michael founded the sacred geometry at the time of what some might call the Big Bang. So this is wonderful that we had the one and then the three and the six and the nine, and that the three is the amplifier of oneness. I am taking notes these days on 3x5 cards instead of journals, and I'm finding that quite interesting way to review the notes and keep them clear. And I would encourage my Candy Shop Show fans to think of using the index card system. And so, like, now I have one for Lucifer and one for Michael, or Macau, as he'd like to be called. And Christopher, can you tell us what Lucifer looks like today?
Yes, he actually wears a white outfit. It's kind of like, I want to say it has a kind of a Roman or a Greek look to it. And he has, let me see, he sometimes has a cape, sometimes he doesn't have one. It's kind of like a half cape on the back. Sometimes it's like red or darker maroon. And he has blonde hair and blue eyes. His hair goes down to the lower back. And he sometimes has a staff with him, a golden staff with like a little orange pyramid in the center. And there's three sides that go up and almost like a fork. So I assume people misinterpreted that as his pitchfork, so to speak. And the little pyramid in the center spins on top of an orb. And that's apparently the symbol of his house. And all of the Elohim members have stabs with their symbols on top. And I thought that was pretty interesting. I usually see Lucifer in a white outfit, but this time I see him in armor, like Michael. Michael wears like a silver and gold colored armor with cuneiform script all along around the where the arms come out of his armor plating, and in the center and everything, there's cuneiform script all over the place that moves and lights up. And Lucifer has something similar, but he has the red cape off the back, and he has some blue in there too. It looks like the pant legs look like they're blue mesh, almost like a, oh God, it looks almost like chainmail, but it's like a bluish color. And he's wearing, I can see, large boots. And let me see, and he also has a helmet, too.
Now, are we talking about Miguel now or Lucifer?
This is Lucifer. You know, Miguel has armor, too. It looks like they're similarly dressed this time. But only Lucifer has, like, this chainmail along his legs. Let me see. He has a helmet that's very similar to a Greek or Corinthian helmet with the nose piece that comes down over the nose. I've never seen him wear armor before. So this is new. Michael, I've seen wear armor, but I've never seen Lucifer in his armor before.
Okay. Well, we're getting serious, aren't we? Oh, well, I thank both of them for the sharings, and I often think of the three as representing wisdom, love, and power.
Mm-hmm.
And you mentioned these three beings, and I might like to get the spelling. I think you said Christos, Hoag, and Hotan?
Hotan, yes. And they represent similar things within the Pleiadian collective. Like Hoag is the warrior, Christos is the scientific mind, and Hotan is the spiritual voice.
So could you spell Hoag?
Yes, it's H-O-A-G. And as far as I know, Christos is spelled similar to my name. I might have it wrong. It is C-R-I-S-T-A-S. And Hotan is O-R-T-O-N.
So Hotan represents the spiritual, Hoag the warrior. And what did you say, Christos?
The logical or the scientific mind.
Okay. This is great that they can help us like that. These three counterbalancing the three cabal heads. In a way.
Mm-hmm. Yes, kind of to make sure there's a balance in there, to make sure they can help counteract or cancel out the cabal power heads.
Right. Well, we mentioned a little bit ago about the financial change and October being important for that. And I was wondering, in the past, we've gone in and we've done some clearing out of the Capitol building and the Pentagon. And I was wondering if we could lend any assistance to the very important office in Washington, D.C., the Office of Budget, the Government Budget Office that tries to keep accurate records and keep things legal. So I was wondering if we could have any galactic that might help us the Office of the Budget to help more smoothly make the financial change. I know, you know, we're looking forward to eventually a day like in Star Trek world and on other civilizations where they don't need money at all. But we know that there needs to be a transition before we can get there.
Yes, we can look at that. Let's see if anybody else is showing up. And you know, I can actually see the building right now. But what is interesting, you'll actually enjoy this one. It's very similar to this looks to be a very similar trip that I took when I looked at the Pentagon, because there are a multitude of guides showing up. I mean, an extreme over amount of beings showing up, very similar to the Pentagon vision set. So let's see here.
You can count on Candy to ask the big questions.
Yeah, because usually when there's this many guides, there's something massive. So I'm going to see. I can see the Syrian star beings are the ones that kind of led the charge on that one. And Michael and Lucifer are telling me that there's something big here. So I'm going to look. It looks like they are standing close to me. And it looks like the members of the Elohim are surrounding me in a bubble. So this means that they're wanting me to be extremely protected in this one. So I'm going to look. Now there's a bubble they put around me that's slightly distorted, but I can still do this. And I see the building, and I'm seeing strange lights moving inside of the building, like orbs. I don't know if people that work there have seen like apparitions. Oh, Michael here just pointed out he used the term blue beam. So so this should be very interesting. I'm going to see if this has to do with Project Blue Beam at all.
Yes, we were told Project Blue Beam wouldn't happen as the Cabal had planned.
Mm-hmm.
I just want to apply the Law of One prayer for the highest good of all concerned as we go in here. And so it is, so be it. Thank you.
Okay, let's see. I'm looking inside this building, and I'm seeing these white orbs kind of trail around inside the hallways. The hallways are very distorted, very image-like. They're very... it's almost like an hallucination, like if somebody was walking through a bed... like acid trip or something. This is very weird, where very surreal looking, and I'm asking why this is so strange. And they're kind of grinning at me, so apparently I have to figure this one out myself. Okay, I'm going to look inside these hallways, and I'm seeing other beings walking around inside these distortions, and it's extremely disorienting. And I'm trying to look out of a window from the hallway. And this energy flowing in here is very weird. And they're telling me to look below, so that's what I'm doing. And I'm trying to see what it is that they're having me look at here. Underneath the building, I am seeing this very strange shaped. I don't want to call it a stone. It looks more like an energy field shaped in a point. It looks pink and blue in coloring. And it's an extremely intense energy field. And Michael just said it's holographic in nature. And they are this is directly under the building. I'm asking him how far. Let's see. He says several floors down in a sub-basement area, like where the Cabal likes to hang out in their underground.
What building is this?
This is that budget building that Candy mentioned.
Oh, okay.
And this is very strange for something of this nature. I'm trying to think what the Cabal is trying to accomplish here with Blue Beam. Why is this so... so big for them? And I'm seeing if the people in the building are to blame for this, and they're telling me no, it's the people that are underneath the building that are. So I'm going to look at this piece of equipment, and it almost makes me want to vomit looking at this thing because it's so disorienting. And I'm asking the guides to come in here and block these effects because it is, it's like looking in a funhouse mirror. And I'm going to surround, I'm going to throw the law of one into this weird holographic matrix and see what happens. And I'm throwing light in there, and it's contorting, and it's turning into these weird swirls that are shooting out everywhere. And let me see. These swirls are now breaking up, and the disorientation within the building is ceasing. And I'm looking at what was coming out of what this distortion was, and I'm looking at a piece of equipment now. It looks like a platform with four legs, and these legs have holes along the inside. It kind of looks like a something that you'd see on a film set. It's some kind of camera, some kind of holographic projector or camera. And I'm seeing I don't want to say cable. It's too thick to be a cable. It's like more like a pipe. And it is connected to a wall. The wall looks like it has veins running up and down it. And it's weird. It's like cords running up and down a wall. And it is, if I didn't know any better, I'd swear there's an artificial intelligence in here. Let's see. I'm sensing consciousness. Let me see. There is definitely an artificial intelligence inside this piece of equipment. Let me see here. And it is trying to speak to me. And Michael is yelling at me to quarantine it, so that's what I'm going to do. I'm putting a cage around it with the sacred geometry. And he's saying that's good, and it's trying to lift out of the facility and outside, and it's trying to take the form of a rainbow so nobody sees it. And they're bagging this AI consciousness. It tried going out as forms of like luminescent colored light, and let me see. They basically bagged it in an energy net. All the guides did. And I'm asking what they're going to do with it. And they said they're going to save it. And I said, is this an AI or is this something else? They said it's a little of artificial intelligence. And there's something else in here they're not telling me. Let's see.
Chris?
Hmm?
I'm intuishing this is one of the, I don't know, those 12 things that we took care of, some of them, but some needed to be taken care of later, but they were still at the highest good of all concerns.
Mm-hmm.
I'm thinking this is one of them. I don't know. Maybe you can ask.
Yeah, this could be one of the last things to be taken care of. I'm asking them, and they said yes and no. It's very similar. There are offshoot things to some of these remaining objects, too. I'm asking them if this AI was found, like Happy was, or if it was created. And they said it was, let's see, was it found? Yeah, it was found. It was created. And there's another being that's approaching me, a brand new ET presence. And this looks to be a different race. This one individual wanted to speak in association with this find, and it looks like his people, this particular new race, was there to help quarantine this. And okay, he's wanting to speak. I'm making sure he's of the highest good first. Okay, now if I could describe him for a minute, he's kind of hunched over. He's gray in color. He kind of looks like an insectoid, like a mantis, but he's really not. He's not a bug. He has kind of bug-bird features in a way. He kind of reminds me of both. And Michael's telling me he's a type of reptile, but he doesn't look like any species I've seen so far. He has like a Y-shaped head with like these little horns that come up, and the rest of his head is kind of almost, I don't want to say football shaped, but he's definitely a new species. And he's telling me, he says, my name is Raimon of Nirmos, and I am of the Remorn people, and I wish to state that this technology in part was stolen from my people on a planet across your galaxy by the Cabal individuals you have found here this evening. They stole this holographic technology from us and combined it with what the rogue Anunnaki people, as you say, showed them how to combine it with their own technology to make what you people know as holograms. It eventually downgraded and became what you people know as compact discs, laser discs, DVDs, and Blu-ray discs. These are all derived from my people. Your governmental bodies are benefiting from what the Raimon people have created. However, we do not mind if the people themselves benefit, so long as one governmental body does not benefit. I am Raimon of... He's speaking a very different language, so give me just a second. My brain is having trouble translating, and I may not even have gotten the planet name right. Raimon de Peep, he's kind of slurring a little bit. I apologize for the incompatibility distortion waves. Our people are very different species on a matrix level. Apologies for interruption in speech. The planet that was given at the beginning of the recording is the proper pronunciation and enunciation of my world, though this one has forgotten the syllables. Worry not. My species is of a density, as you say, that interacts with the realm of shadow, as Lucifer has earlier stated. In this interaction will cause cloudiness and forgetfulness in humans. If this was not being recorded now, humans would forget my people on a whim. This is not by choice. This is a matter of physics entirely. We aim to fix this little problem, as you say. My people are not in the habit of judging others, but for your cabal individuals, we will make an exception. This thievery will not go unchallenged. This brazen piracy, as your people would say, is not acceptable. Though we agree with your law of one, as you say, when one is harmed, all are harmed, and when one is helped, all are helped. So therefore, we will help the people that oppose the cabal. We will help the people by giving them fully the technology that the cabal has stolen. This will balance the playing field, as you humans say. We will give this technology at the advent of full disclosure, meaning prior to this technology, as I have stated, has been dumbed down, as you say, for your film industry and for children's toys, as you say, but have also been used in your computer screens, in your television screens, in your, let's see, he's using other words here, in your interactive displays on your smartphones, slightly bastardized, as you say, by the cabal's tracking devices therein, and the draconian energy vampiric, as you say, devices therein, the televisions that have been since disabled. No small feat, I must add. I must also add that my people have visited yours in the ancient times. We are listed in your biblical histories, as you say, and in your Roman and Greek mythological histories. My people have been listed amongst the Olympian gods, though they be of Nibiru. My people were called Proteus by the individual humans. It was more of a slur at the time, but then became a term of endearment later. Proteus to the ancient Greek and Roman people was more of a ugliness, though that your dictionaries will not say as such. It was meant as a slight insult, meaning Proteus, the ugly god, or Proteus, the malformed person. But this is all in the past, or water under the bridge, as you humans say, is true. Some of your architecture stems from my people's from our people's conceptions. There we go. I myself was on Earth in the age of your Roman Empire, during the time of Marcus Aurelius, the Emperor of Rome. He was said to be a kind and wise man. However, he did invade some of his neighbors in accordance with human power, lustfulness. He did try to outlaw certain abominations, such as the gladiatorial games, but only for a short period of time until the Black Cube, as you have come to know it as, reasserted these games with future emperors. Thankfully, that has gone by the wayside in the past and the present. Thankfully, the time travel capabilities of the cabal have waned, or we would all be under their boot, as you say. I, myself, Ramon, have been witness to what humanity has done in the past and what other invaders have shown themselves. The Draconians and the Arconians are not the only two to have affected negative change in your timelines. Rogue Anunnaki being another, but there are other races known only to us that have affected your species evolutionary traits, some of which integrated their agendas into the fabric and tapestry of Earther humans. These species come from our neck of the woods, as you say. We know of only one that still walks the surface of the earth besides ourselves. These beings have remained out of sight and out of mind, as you humans say. They are but a wisp of energy. They look as a transparent energy field with many orbical apparitions within. These beings have been seen off and on along the surface of your world. They are not humanoid in nature. They are both made of plasma and energy. They are not, as you say, intelligent, because they sacrificed their intelligence for power back in the days of the Roman Empire and Greek empires. Their punishment, as you say, by when the Anunnaki, as you call them, went horribly wrong, was to lose their intelligence and wander the earth as a dumb creature, as you say. Their energies have been seen as more of a whimsical enchantment, as you say, but they could be much more than they are. They are but a flash of light in the corner of your eye. They exist only to wander. This penance, as you say, was unjust. So, while Mikhail and Lucifer are here, I ask them to lift this curse that their people imposed on these poor, unfortunate souls, as you humans say. And now it looks like...
Oh, yes.
Looks like...
For the highest good of all concerns.
Mm-hmm. Lucifer and Michael are actually happy this came out, because I've actually seen things like this where it's like a mist of like energy with like little twinkles in it, and I didn't know what it was. And they are saying, look for one of them, so that I'm doing that. And I'm looking for one of them. It looks like in a wooded area. Oh, I'm being told there is something near you, Candy. There's a being close by in like a wooded area. A lot of the nature guardians are pointing to it. Let me see. It looks like one of these beings is just kind of wandering around aimlessly. So I'm hitting it with the law of one. And it's taking a form other than just a blob. I can see... it's taking like a weird shape, almost like a bird, but only it's plasma and energy. And it is saying, greetings, my name is Borl. I'm having a hard time understanding him. Bor, okay, B-O-R, Bor. And he is, okay, and I am that of a distant world. We were once as your phoenix in the sun. We were that of energy and matter, but we decided to take sides, as it were, in the great wars. We were then punished thusly by the victors of those wars. we chose poorly. We should have remained that of a neutral base. But we wanted to try to help the poor, unfortunate draconians that fed on people's energy fields. We could not defeat their magic and their minds and their will. So we ended up binding with a few of them. And when the Orions came and punished the Draco, we were punished with them. We did not know why. We now understand what has occurred, and I'm asking him to show me where the rest of his kind are. And he's telling me, he says, all over the Earth's surface, they wander like almost like icebergs floating on the ocean. And they look like just blobs of energy. And I'm showing him that law of one symbol. I asked him if he could spread it to the rest of them. And he says, for certain. So he's spreading that to all of them, and they're all taking like those bird looking like wispy bird forms. It's not quite a bird. It's more of like a lit up like angelic statue like form. It's hard to explain. But they're very wispy looking, cloud like. And they're all speaking as one voice now. And they are saying, it looks like they're going to give me a name. They said, we are the Forbosi. We are the collective minds of a once matter-based people. The Forbosi lived in peace with our neighbors, the Mkhang. But they saw that we tried to take sides in a war that was not our own. They attempted to warn us that we would not fare well in such a decision. But we decided against that of common sense, as you humans say. For 10,000 of your centuries, we have wandered away from our homelands, but the Forbosi minds now can re-enter the realms of the flesh and the blood. We are the core energy that came from such fleshy forms. We attempted to evolve beyond that form using technology-based devices. As you say, these devices are still in operation on our home world, as are our bodies. So we now open a rift to our home of Laurel. We now may go home again. We thank the humans for their kindness and the Orions for their change in attitude towards us. Even Mikhail was not without his faults once, but that is a different story altogether. I will not point fingers beyond that. My name is Bor of the Forbosi Mines, and I can go back to our home again. And now he sounds like he's fading into the background.
We're just so grateful. We're just so grateful that you tried to help and that we have been a channel to return you to your home in your fleshy forms, and may your future be bright.
And he sang, "My people, the Forbosi," sang the human minds of this. We show love eternal and will aid humans in their evolution and revolution against the Cabal people. We must go home to tend to our physical forms, which are very similar to your own. They have been in stasis, as you say, for a long, long time. We must go back to tend to them, but will return soon in physical forms to aid in what you humans call full disclosure. That is, if the Orions will allow this to take place ever the earlier than their projected date, as we see in the minds of this one. And they are now waving, and they're all going back through their portal to their home world. And I can see the Raimon, the original guy that we spoke to, he's kind of clapping and kind of dancing around. And so are them all. I can hear a bunch of cheering going on. And it's like somebody's throwing a party. And I can just hear the cheering. I can't see it. I can just see Raimon just kind of dancing around, but I can hear cheering. And he says,
"Hallelujah." His people,
he says his people thank the humans as well. And, of course, they're thanking the Orions. But it seems I'm almost feeling a slight tension when some of these species talk about the Orions. But they're still shaking hands with them and hugging them and everything. I think they're remembering an old time, an old past, but that's over now. So they're all dancing. It looks like Raimon is now waving, and he is now leaving, and he's going back to that star system to help the Forbosi, and along with his people. I'm seeing what his ships look like, too. They kind of, let me see here. They have kind of like these propeller-looking apparatuses on the back. And they look, on the front, they kind of look like what one of our airplanes would look like, but without wings. And the propeller-looking apparatus on the back is some kind of star drive. And it's shaped kind of like not a teardrop, but it's shaped like a cigar shape. But it has this drive on the back, and it has a cockpit at the front, how we would have in airplanes. And they are, and Raimon was saying as he was leaving, he goes, "This design too was stolen by humans, but never you mind that." And they are, I can see them taking off towards their system, and their planet, along with the Forbosi's planet, has this purple and green luminescence to it. And it looks like they're in the same star system. And if I could judge what the Forbosi look like as physical forms in their stasis tubes, they kind of look like humans, but they have a very rough texturing on their skin, not like scales, but... it's hard to explain. It's kind of almost fishy in a way where kind of like along their cheeks there's like this scaling that goes downward, almost kind of like how scale armor is, folding downward, and they have a white complexion. And I can see... Okay, yeah, now I see Boar has returned to... His physical form in the stasis tube is opened up, and I can see what he actually looks like in his physical form instead of the wispy look. And I'm asking him if his species are more like fish, and he says yes. That's why they have this fishy look to him. He said fish and reptilian. And I asked if they're related to anybody in the Cirrus system. They said no, that those were the Myrmidons. And let me see. He says, He goes, blessings to humanity. I am Boar, and I am now in my body once again. My electromagnetic field is thusly back in place. And he is showing me his energy matrix, like when I look into somebody's energy matrix to heal them. And he's showing me his energy, his people's energy matrix are made up of three spheres. Instead of us having the seven chakras or eight chakras, we have, or they have three. And that goes back to the number three now. They look like planetoids that are almost connected, almost like that kind of rotate around each other in waves. And they can either go vertically or horizontally. And he says, for future reference, if I see an energy signature like this, this is a member of the Forbosi community that's on Earth. And even though humans can attain a similar look in their energy matrix, it's still kind of blue with like a sun in the center. But these beings, it looks like, it's like that child's toy that's the plasma ball, you know, from like a science class. And there's three orbs that look like that inside of them. And one of them is inside of their brain, and there's two more in the lower body. But he's saying, for future reference, that's what a Forbosi energy core looks like. And he's showing me around this city he's in. He says, we must effect repairs. The place is dirty, so excuse the mess. It's been over 10,000 centuries since they've been walking around. And let me see. Looks like they're hauling a couple of their people to a medical bay. It looks like some of the stasis chambers failed. And he says, don't worry. They can regenerate from a single cell when they get the energy core back. So they're not actually dead. So let me see. They have buildings that are very similar to ours. They're white, and they're kind of almost looks like they're made of, it kind of reminds me of a sandcastle. And I'm asking them, are they underwater? Because I feel slow as I'm walking through here. And he says, interesting that I would say that, because they are underwater. They're breathing water. They can't actually breathe air. And their structures look like sandcastles, with curved openings for windows and everything like that. And I'm seeing lights go on in a bunch of the houses. He said they're a complete aquatic species, that if they were here on Earth in their physical bodies, they would have to be in the ocean. Yeah, just kind of like the Myrmidons. Let me see. And he's showing me all the lights in their cities are coming on again, and I'm seeing ships moving in and out of a corridor. And the ships kind of look like the same energy formations that are within them. They kind of look like a plasma ball inside of a bubble. And on the interior of the bubble are the pilots, and they're not sitting upright like how we would in a plane. They are sitting along the interior walls. There are three pilots of one of these ships, and there's one at the bottom, and then one at the top, and then one along the side, and they kind of rotate around each other as they fly through the water. And it looks like a bunch of bubbles with energy flowing through them. And I'm asking his people if they are high density, and he says yes. He says they are, 18th density. And they are now finally able to reassert their cities. It looks like they have some machines, too, that are affecting repairs under this ocean. I'm looking on this planet, I'm looking above the water just to see where this is. And he's showing me the surface. He says the entire planet is nothing but water except for one small landmass that is at the lower edge of the planet. And there's like a rock formation sticking up, and it looks like it has a statue or something on it. Let me see. He says, yes, there's a statue, but it's like a warning signpost because it looks like this thing's a volcano. That which could potentially create land. And he says, yes, exactly. But the majority of the planet's water. And I asked if they could survive on Earth if they were physically here. And he says, for certain, the chemical makeup of the atmosphere is similar. And the water is very similar in salt composition and everything. Let me see. They are... Yes, and he's eager to show me the whole planetoid. And the other guy is showing me, he's kind of interceding and saying he's showing me his world, and it's nothing but a desert. So one's a desert species, and the other is a waterfaring species that evolved in the same solar system. And it looks like in their solar system they have a binary system. They have a yellow sun like ours, and they have a smaller star. Oh, they said it's not a binary system. I'm seeing some kind of construct or space station. And they have a yellow sun just like Sol is. And the construct is taking energy and passing it on to the two species that are in that system. And I'm asking them if there are any more species in that system, and they said no, just them. And let me see. Okay, now they are. Now I can see the images starting to fade. It looks like they're wanting to get back to doing what they're doing, so it looks like they're leaving now.
Well, thank you all. Thank you. 18th city, and may you be blessed, and yes, perhaps you can come and help us at the time of the disclosure.
Yeah, that was good. It looks like, yeah, and Michael and Lucifer are bowing out now too. It looks like they were all bowing out.
Thank you, Michael, Lucifer. Wow, that's amazing. That we could free those, 10,000 centuries, that's 1 million years. That's a long time to be punished. And we have used the love of the law of one to free them. And they have forgiven those that bound them.
It seems that all the time I run into a new species that's been bound in some way from like either the old war times or from another universe or something like that. Sometimes they're very small, like a fairy being, or there's something large, like a physical being, like the Fribosi. They tend to run the gambit, but I'm always finding somebody new.
Well, again, we have only touched on two of the 20 topics that I would like to talk about sometime, but this is important work. Is there any message that we humans should know or be prepared for in the next week? And we have this Arctic blast coming in. We know that Mother Gaia is cleansing the pollution and things, and now, we've heard about the nuclear power plant that's so dangerous near Chicago. Is there anything that we should be doing to prepare and expect and ask for some help for in the coming 7 days?
Yeah, it looks like Joyous is going to answer this one. Joyous of Ligarius. And he says, worry not. The Ligarian people are helping to balance the Arctic winds, as you say, seeing as that it is an imbalance caused by the cabal and not an act of nature. Their usage of harp caused this mess, as your mother Gaia has stated before. She, along with us are helping to spread the joyous energy, joyful energy across your world to calm these instances within the next 7 days. The Arctic winds are a much lower chill factor, as you humans would say, than they should be. This type of chill factor, as you say, will kill plant and animal life forms. The Earth is trying to rebalance as a single organism, but is having a rough go of it because of the technology that was once imposed. So we are all stepping in to help Mother Gaia, or as she says, Tiamat, with this endeavor. She shows sometimes great impatience with the cabal, and every now and again tries to turn the tables on them. But this is not her way or her fault. She was just miffed, as you humans say, at them and their wretchedness, as she would say. And I'm seeing her consciousness here as well, since she was mentioned so many times. She kind of shows up if she's spoken about. And I'm seeing her face, and she's saying, people of my physical realm, there is nothing to be concerned with in this next week. I, the one you know of as Mother Gaia, or as I am actually called, Tiamat of Orion, I say to you that these things you think have merit, as you say, though they do, are handled in the highest good of all concerned. I, though I appear to have impatience, as Joyous of Ligarius has stated, do in fact do from time to time. I do have a physical form, as you humans do, and how would you enjoy it if you had people on your back destroying parts of yourself? You would not be pleased. But in this realm, I must show more of a tolerance and patience towards these beings. I have begun the split off, as you humans would say, from the vibration in which they will remain thusly. I have already begun this, and this frightens them to no end, though I must resist laughing at this because it is not very enlightened. I cannot help myself. They enjoy judgment so very much. They will be removed from the game board, as Lucifer has stated, but by their own actions and by the actions of the benevolent extraterrestrials, as you say, and that of the benevolent human resistance. This will not be too far coming into the future, but I digress. This week alone will be wrought with joyous, and not just the frog being that is standing next to me. The joyous, I mean, is that of oneness and kindness and tranquility. Think of the best place that I have to offer you, humans, the best garden or the best mountainscape or the best beach or the best waterfall or the best forest. Think of that when you think of me, and not these Arctic winds or these intolerable temperatures, both hot and cold, the earthquakes that are not only just wrought by myself, but the underground battles that continue to this day. Don't think of the negative when you think of me. It makes me slightly impatient and intolerant when I should not be. These are what human thoughts can manifest in the overall whole. So when you think of those good places, project that towards myself, and that will also aid and expedite this shift that much sooner. Thank you.
Well, thank you. Thank you, Mother Gaia. And I didn't mean to be critical or blaming. And I'm glad to understand your position and your other name, Tamat. We need to be closing fairly soon. Did the frogman wish to say something, though?
Let's see. He just says, all he's saying is everyone he knows of, he calls joy. Every, person, place, and thing he refers to as joy, and he wishes humans to do the same.
Perfect, yes. Yes. Joyful loving, as I was saying in the mantra, just joy everywhere. And that's great. It's great. I saw the movies of the snow in Saudi Arabia in on the path to Mecca, and the children and even the adults were joyfully playing with the snow and making the snowballs in the desert there. Well, friends, thank you for your patience and listening, and I hope those on the YouTube will try to tune in to what it was that Chris was seeing I hope that we can see some better things coming out of the Office of Budget Management, and that we can all understand the powerful numbers that we were talking about. And as they said, 1111, that is about your thoughts. And you should consider your positive thoughts. And really, when you get the 1111 message, and connect and think about the thoughts and what you were thinking about at that time, and realize that, hey, your guardian angels, they have confirmed that those are good thoughts and that you're right on track. And be joyous about that. Be joyous every time you see 1111. Well, Chris, this is wonderful, and I think you're – are you going to share the platform also on Monday with Elizabeth and her other guests, or will you be absent Monday?
I will be absent Monday because Monday is my birthday. So
wonderful.
Happy birthday.
Well, yes. Have a joyous
thank
birthday.
You. Yeah,
and then
you.
You'll be back on my show for the a week from tonight.
Yes.
Wonderful. Wonderful. Well, I celebrated my birthday for 2 weeks, and so I encourage you to do as well. Gosh. It's very late, so I think that we're going to wrap this up now, and I appreciate those in attendance. And if anybody wants to send me a question, comment, suggestion, my email is keytotruth@yahoo.com. That's keytotruth@yahoo.com to reach Candy. And just have a joyous week. And the schools are closed. Businesses are closed where I am. And just use the extra time to do more meditating and love those and forgive those in your world. and send joyous thoughts to our ET brothers and sisters that are helping us. Isn't that right, Chris?
Yes, exactly. That's exactly what Joyous was stating.
Okay, that sounds great. Well, it's a wrap. Good night, everyone.
Good night, everybody.